بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا حبيبنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. There was something that I wanted to talk about today, actually, that was really heavy on my heart. And I wanted to, you know, I wanted to bring it to you because I read in the, there's a narration that our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala an, when she was in the end of her life, that she was known to actually sit alone and cry and say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, what is this thing that you created called Aisha? What is this thing that you have created, Ya Allah? Where basically, you know, by the time she reached her late 50s and early 60s, that it was something that she even, she was like contemplating. It's those moments you begin to go over your life and you start to say, like, you know, who am I and what have I done and what have I accomplished? And one of the things that for me reminds me of it, like it really heavy, is that when it when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually describes that first, what they call the minor day of judgment, that when the angel of death comes and he takes the soul, subhanAllah, taking it from this portion and it begins to be removed. And then they wrap the soul. Either it's taken, of course, with gentleness and love, like I said, like milk being poured from a pitcher. Oh, yeah, the bina. I don't want to talk about the opposite. That's not what I'm talking about today. But subhanAllah, then the angels actually come and they wrap the soul either in a very beautiful cloth or a putrid smelling, like wretched cloth. And as they're going, through the heavens, for this what's considered the minor day of judgment, the angels approach the first door of heavens and they ask, and the angels basically they ask for permission and they say, well, who is it, right? Who is it that's come? And they say, well, this is such and such, and they give the person's name and they say, you know, their lineage, like this is Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam, you know, the son of Abdullah. So they begin to give a list. And then they say, well, what was said about this person, right? And so then the angel who's accompanying the soul begins to repeat what people said about the person in the world. So if they say, well, this is a dakira, this is a saliha, right? This is a mukhlisa. This is someone, this is a woman of charity. This is a woman of kindness. This is a woman of, right? This is a woman of salah. She's of those who used to cry to Allah in the night. This is a mashallah. This is Ahlul Quran. This is someone of Quran. And then the angel, subhanAllah, actually then allow this soul to then enter that level of the heavens until they reach the seventh. And at this particular, this seventh, this gateway is, they say it, to the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is where it becomes another level. And at this level, subhanAllah, when it's basically the words are, you know, that they've been hearing about this soul are then pretty much weighed. To not on a scale, it's different. It's not the mizan, it's not the major day, but this is their kind of weighed. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually speaks, because there's a judgment that's given about how this soul will return to the grave. And so subhanAllah, at each door, for example, in the beginning, it's like, okay, is this a person of shahada? Is this someone who then prayed their prayers? Did they pray it correctly with the correct fiqh? Then it's like, okay, did they pray it, you know, with concentration? But then, subhanAllah, when they get to this, and it's, of course, it's not just only the salat, but other actions, other deeds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked of them. But when they get to that seventh door, it's the door of sincerity, right? It's the gateway of sincerity. And so now it's no longer about what the people have said. It's no longer about the words that have actually been thrown out. It's actually now, is it that what they've presented to the people? Yes, inside the masjid, they were from the musallin, right? Yes, you know, and with their family, they were those who prayed. But when everyone left, did they actually pray? Right? That when everyone, you know, they were the people who were generous and kind in front of people, right? But maybe, subhanAllah, what did, you know, when their children speak about them, what do they say? Does it match? But then at that door of sincerity, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now speaking to the internal condition of that soul, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is then saying, actually, وَإِيَّاذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not number us in this category of those I'm about to describe. But there are those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says to the malaika, actually they were not of those who prayed. There was no khudu, there was no khushu', there was no hudur, there was no ikhlas, that they prayed in front of people. Wa iyadu billah. And the scary part in this narration is that it speaks to that these deeds, subhanAllah, are then some of them are thrown back on this person's face. Right? And the angels will say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, we didn't know. Right? We didn't know what was in their hearts. We're just looking at the record. And according to the record, they prayed. Right? Fajr, we have it. Dhuhr, we have it. It's written that they prayed. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, now we're looking at their internal condition. And that determines how that person is going to spend their time in the grave. I didn't speak to the depth of that, subhanAllah, with your daughters. Right? And we're like, oh my God, is that what she's saying? No. But when we're talking about identity, that for us, it's different. Right? Sometimes we do things because it's like, that's what we've been doing. I grew up doing that. Or that's what my family does. Right? Or we do it because that's the group of people that we are around. But in reality, there will come a day when the truth of who we are will speak. As we know that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, subhanAllah, our eyes will speak and tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exactly what happened. Right? Our mouth will speak and not from our command. Right? Our hands will speak and not from our command. That these things, and I ask subhanAllah, like, why would our eyes speak? Why are our ears going to speak? Why are our hands going to speak? Because they're going to tell the truth of the reality. Right? They're going to be able to say, listen, this is what really happened. Right? This is the reality of this human being. And then you're not, that day, you won't be able to cover it up. And so then it becomes incumbent upon us to be able to say, who am I really? And how am I going? Not only to, this is not just about my integrity. How am I going to really be from amongst the mu'mineen? How am I going to really be who the people of the as-salihin, salihat? How am I really going to gain the kind of internal character, the kind of internal purity, the type of internal relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that's going to be something that I know that my deeds are not going to be thrown back? Right? Like, it's not just subhanAllah, because it's true. Sometimes we pray because other people are praying. Or we even pray because, okay, we told our children we have to pray, so now we're praying for it. Right? But what is it for us to say, Ya Rabbi, no, I'm not even praying to you when we get to the level, right? I'm not even praying to you because you commanded me. I'm praying to you because I love you. I worship you because you're Allah and you deserve to be worshipped. I worship you because I love you. I worship you because I want a relationship with you, right? I want to be close to you. I want to be exactly who it is that you created me to be. I don't want any other being, any other woman. I don't want to be her. I want to be the woman you want me to be. Adore me with the qualities that you love. Make me that person. That's really what our ibadah is about. Right? That's really what our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is about. Because there are two things. We'll look at them. If we look at them on the higher level, we say, oh Allah, if I don't get the house of gold, right, or the house of pearls, or the streets of gold, or the one scarf, one woman's scarf in Jannah will be worth the entire dunya and everything in it. Right? One of her scarves. Some women are like, I remember one time I told a group of that, and they're like, wait, we have to wear hijab in the Jannah? And I was like, if you want, it's just, right? It's just one of her scarves. It's just like an accessory if you want it, right? That is worth more than everything in the dunya. But even in that, are we thinking about, Ya Rabbi, I want Jannah because what you got to give me? Because the stuff? Right? Like that's on the akhirah side. On the dunya side, And we're saying, well, you know, I'm worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because, you know, He'll give me success. He'll give me money. He'll give me a family. He'll give me this or that or whatever. My children will be, I'm praying for my children. You know, I want my children, I want my child to be a surgeon, right? Or the next CEO of this company. Or I want, you know, I don't want them to do bad things. So I'm praying because I just don't want my children to do bad things. Why? Because I don't want to be ashamed in public. I don't want, you know, we're really, even though, subhanAllah, we're inside the deen, right? We're coming to the masjid, we're doing all the things, but then there's an underlayer of like, still I'm still concerned about what people think of me. Really, I worship Allah, not really because I want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because I just worship Allah because I'm just afraid that if I don't, then I won't have a good life. That's still, right? It's still you're worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based upon what He gives you or He doesn't give you. It's still not a relationship with Allah. It's actually deen for dunya. Actually, they're still, believe it or not, you're saying, well, we're not outside the fold of Islam, we're Muslim, but there's still a shirk in our ibadah. We're still associating something with our ibadah. Right? We're still associating my worship with Allah with what He's going to give me. That's why I'm worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because He's Allah, but, you know, like, yeah, I know He's Allah. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, alhamdulillah. But I don't really have a relationship with Allah. What I have a relationship with is like, I want a good husband, right? I want a really nice house in the suburbs. I want like a 2-car, right? I want like the minivan and the SUV. You know, maybe if my husband gets a motorcycle, we can go on the weekend. Whatever it is, right? Whatever it is. This is, for us, where we have to be concerned with. Right? Because what if you are tried? What happens if you're worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is our current state? What if I'm worshiping Allah and I'm still tried? I'm worshiping Allah and I still get sick. I'm worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and something still happens with my family. Something still happens with my marriage. Something still happens with my health. Something still happens with my children. What happens then? Sometimes people lose their iman. Because they're saying, well, Ya Rabbi, I worship you, so now you owe me. I worshiped you. How did I get here? This wasn't supposed to happen. And it's because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the secret about yourself that you weren't willing to tell yourself. And that is, you're worshiping me because of what I give you or I don't give you. That the relationship is not sincere. The sincere relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like that moment of Hajar. When she's in the desert all by herself and a child. Like, seemingly, you got nothing. You got no home. You've been long taken from your tribe. You've got no land of your own. Meaning you're far away from your original country. You're far away from any tribe who knows anything about who you are. At that time, Hajar did not speak the language, subhanAllah, of what would become the Meccan Valley. So you are totally foreign. It doesn't even matter that you're foreign because ain't nobody here. Right? Nobody's even here. And then when they come, they don't know you. So you could still be alone in a group of people. That's when I think about our mother Hajar. I think about that. And then, subhanAllah, it's not just, it's one thing to say, I'm alone in a group of people. I'm in a strange land. I don't have the protection of my husband. I don't have the comfort of my family. I don't have like my sister I can go over to her house and laugh about it. Remember when we were kids and dad did that. I don't have any of that. But on top of that, I still have to maintain a level of strength to raise this child. I still have to maintain a level of happiness to raise this child. I still got to maintain, I got to show up every day as a mom and be perky and be a role model. Right? That's another, some people's like, oh, that's comfort. That's like, whoa, y'all. Right? that honestly, it's seeming like, Ya Rabbi, I already suffered. I came, I showed up. Why? Our mother Hajar, and I talk about her a lot, because her life for me is just fascinating. Her life for me, just her moments of like, it's just absolutely fascinating to me. Like, what kind of iman is that? What kind of tawakkul is that? What type of yaqeen is that? What kind of perseverance is that? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm going to build the whole city around you. Like this relation, this like the ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brags about. Right? The ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brags about in the Quran. I'm like, subhanAllah, this is something amazing. That's something we could just study their life. But when you are, if you imagine those moments, she has to have one thing clear. That if all those things about my identity are stripped away, my culture doesn't matter in this moment, my tribe doesn't matter. If I had any money, I don't have it now. Right? If I had a great husband who was very influential, mashallah, my husband is a prophet of Islam. Well, he's not here now. Now who are you? Now who are you? What's the importance of it? And that's when we get to the most baseline answer, that we are servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we are His creation, that we are His creation, He created us, and we're going back to Him. And the only thing that's actually going to matter, all the other stuff, literally is gonna decay in the grave. What's gonna matter is who we were to Allah and who we are to Allah. That's what's gonna matter. And not the, even if we associated, right, the give or the not give, the fear of the give and take with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that part is gonna crumble. And it's gonna be like, are you sure you had a relationship with me? Or did you just have a relationship with your hopes and fears? So that's what we have to distill down to. Ya Allah, do I have a relationship with you? Do I know you? Do I praise you? Do I spend time just contemplating with you? Not connected to other people? Not connected even to myself. This is what our great scholars and the awliya used to talk about when they talked about the annihilation. When Allah, I'm just something you created. The only thing that's going to matter, make any difference about who I am, about all of my identity of who I think I am in the world. The only part that's going to matter is who I was to you and what my relationship is with you. And so even as you're reading the Quran, you got to think about, Ya Rabbi, from this Quran, teach me about you. How do I, the lessons, when you're telling me the story about Musa and Khidr, what does it tell me about you? When I'm learning the story about Maryam, what does it teach me about you? When I'm reading through the Quran and learning the lessons about the two men in the garden in Surah Al-Kahf, what does it teach me about you? Ultimately, the only reality is La ilaha illallah. And even inside of the next of it, Muhammad Rasulullah is just to guide you back to who is your Lord. Even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is just saying, I just came to show you who is your Lord. I just came to guide you back to who is Allah. I just came to teach you how to be loved by Allah. How to be loved by Allah, how to matter to Allah, how to be noticed by Allah, how to be accepted by Allah. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now that's a big deal, don't get me wrong, right? That's why he's Sayyidina. Because even inside of the who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who he is, right? And there are things about him that, you know, that show us that, like, okay, yes, no, he's Arab, he's from this family, blah, blah, blah. But in the end, what matters about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I came to connect you to Allah. I came to lay the pathway so that your pathway to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be easy. So even, subhanAllah, as you are identifying ourselves as wives, as mothers, do you identify yourself as a wife to say, I'm here to say, how can I make my husband's pathway to Jannah easy? How can I be closer to Allah through him? By my relationship with him, I become closer to Allah. Why? Because Allah is the reality. Good or bad? How are my children a means by which I become closer to Allah? And when it comes to my relationship with my children, how am I a pathway by which they get to Jannah easy? Why? Because if I become the pathway by which they know Allah, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. So are we a means of ease for them to meet Allah? Or are we actually an obstacle in their way to their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When we think about the people in our life, are we a means by which we facilitate their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with ease? Or are we like a spoke in the wheel? Are we a reminder? Are we a warning? Are we a blessing? Are we a guidance? Who are we? At the end, that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I created you for no other purpose except to worship me. Meaning that once you understand that, like, it's about your relationship with me, all that other stuff, if you still want it, I'll tell you a narration. It's a true story where once I was sitting with it's a group of women. We were in we're having like a gathering in my house, and we went around and we asked everyone, what is it that you yearn for? What is it that you yearn for? And everybody, you know, we were in the desert at the time. So some people were like, I yearn for a washing machine. Some were like, I yearn for air conditioning. I was like, I yearn for Red Lobster. People were like, what do I yearn for? And we got to my teacher, and my teacher said, I yearn to gaze upon Allah and never blink. And that's the description of the highest level in Jannah. The people who are just in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they never blink. Now there's another level where people see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Jummah. And there are some who see, you know, but they're the highest level of those who are in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they never blink. Now some of us, I remember when she said it, I thought, do I even have a heart that knows to yearn for that? Do I have the kind of soul that knows that that's something valuable? Or do we start thinking about, well, do I get to go back down to my house made of pearls? Like, am I still going to get the streets of gold? Like, am I still going to get, like, the super handsome husband? Some of us are still thinking about the stuff, which means that we didn't understand yet. Alhamdulillah, Allah is so kind, so generous. He gives us, like, different... He's like, let me just kind of coax you. You're going to be beautiful. It's going to be great. You're going to have a great time. But really, really, it's about Allah. Really, it's about Allah. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك سيدنا حبيبنا مولانا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم. I want to remind you of this, just this last verse, and it's, you know, we think about it when we talk about each other and sticking together as an ummah. But I'm talking about it just as it relates to us. وَتَصَمِّ بِحَبَلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرُقُ. Right? Hold on together to the rope of Allah and do not be divided. Most we're talking, you know, people think we're talking about, like, you know, this is about the community sticking together. This is also about, don't let your nafs separate from your heart. And don't let your heart separate from your mind. And don't let any of it separate from your soul, from your ruh, your connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't let your nafs take you away from Allah. Don't let your heart, right, that which you're in love with, your spouse, your children, your job, your status, whatever, don't let your heart take you away from your ruh, which is your connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't let your mind, well, I've got to earn this much money, well, I've got to do this in society. Oh no, but you know, Tony Robbins says that I've got to do, heck, don't let your mind take you away from your ruh, your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the verse, what it's really about. There's multiple. But the reason why we get splintered in communities, because first we're splintered inside of our own selves. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Any questions? So let me say this. Sakhrat, I don't know if he's in Sakhrat al-Maut or not. But I will say this. First of all, angels are not always as beautiful as we think. I know we think of like the Hollywood version, right? But they're not always like that. That also, subhanAllah, believe it or not, ugly faces can be a means by which a person will say, La ilaha illallah, right? And so that might even be a means of prodding, of encouraging, right? The person to say, La ilaha illallah, like, or even to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So it doesn't necessarily, I don't want you to just assume straight away, is that a bad thing? When, you know, that if that person then sees that and says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim, that's a good thing. Right? If it becomes a means by which they flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that becomes a good thing. The other thing is that these are also reminders, of course, for us to always repent. Right? And this, alhamdulillah. So even in this case, if you see them, لا إله إلا الله أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم لا you know أعوذ like اللهم أعوذ بالله right like asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. So either way, alhamdulillah, even if him saying it became a means by which he said recite Quran for me, right, then this is something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is facilitating a good ending for him, inshallah bi khair, inshallah, or shifa, whatever Allah intends, I don't know. So even if he's saying the Qarin, even if he's saying Shayateen, or he's saying very fierce angels, right? Because even Umar ibn Khattab, when he described, when there was one other Sahaba who Umar ibn Khattab, he passed away before this other Sahaba. And so when this Hutayfa, I think, when this Sahaba, basically he saw Umar in a dream. And he asked Umar, like, how was it? Right? He asked Umar, how was it? And Umar described Munkar and Nakir. And when he described Munkar and Nakir, scary, right? He said that he said, first of all, their eyes were like cauldron pots, like huge. He said, I could see them even like mountains, like just the span of mountains. And he said that he was blue black in color, and that when he blinked, his eyes flashed like lightnings. He said his teeth were like mountain pegs. And he said when Munkar spoke, he said it sounded like rolling intense thunder. Well, this is Umar al-Khattab. It's Ashara Mubashara. Right? That's not like, I know we were thinking it was going to be like fat little cherry bums, right? Like, you know, flying around, like, you know. No, it's not like that necessarily. Right? And this is very, but subhanAllah, what it tempted Umar to do as a result, right? When, alhamdulillah, shukrillah, when the angel spoke to Umar, he said, you know, he said, Man Rabbuk. which I can't imagine what that's like, you know, like rolling in the Manurah book. And it says that Omar grabbed him, grabbed this angel and said, Manurah book. No, I'm like, who's your Lord? Like, who are you? And then he became, mashallah, he said, yeah, I'm just Munkar. He's like, yeah, Omar, I'm just Munkar. I'm coming to take the report. It's gonna take the reports. I don't know. And he's like, okay. Then la ilaha. Then my answer is la ilaha illallah. So subhanallah. And la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. And sitting, Allahu Allah, Allahu Allah. Allahu Allah, la ilaha illallah. Just keep to reciting his names. That one. Especially in Witr. Spending, or just in Qiyamul Layl, Tahajjud. Sitting in the night when everybody's sleeping. Right? And you just communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and reflect upon the sweetness of your relationship with Allah. And just like, Ya Rabbi, that time you saved me from that. That time you reminded me of that. That time you removed that from my heart. The more you reflect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all the other, it's a pretty scarf. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A scarf, who can, subhanAllah, who can, Ya Rab, give me you, Ya Rab. Ya Allah, give me Allah. That's what we want, Ya Allah. Subhanallah, yes. Yes. So the first thing is that, know this. We all have sins in our hearts, right? We all have sins of our, sometimes we ourselves don't recognize the sins of our own heart, right? Sometimes we, that's just not something we haven't dealt, you know, delve that deeply into our own soul. We haven't spent time with ourselves long enough to kind of contemplate it. And so in those moments of desperation, when we're crying out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I always say this, like, falls out, right? Believe that's actually one of the beauties of the broken heart, is that the beauty of the broken heart is that when it breaks, you're able to see the contents, the true contents of your heart, right? And so you're able to say, subhanAllah, I didn't know that in reality, vanity was there, right? I didn't know that, wow, I didn't realize, like, this is about my greed or this is about my ego, right? And so sometimes it's not until our hearts are broken that we get exposed to our own selves. But the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is if He exposes you to yourself, it's a good sign. It's a very good sign. It says that he said, you know, you got to come back to me. So you have to come back to me. And I want to give you the highest level of Jannah. But if you have this quality, you won't be able to go in that place. So let's work. I'm going to show it to you so I can work on it. And then if I'm giving you, subhanAllah, the tawfiq to make dua about it, that's even, that's like even better. Because of Allah saying, ask me about it. Ask me about, like, subhanAllah. You don't even have to have, like, all the tools. Like, you don't have to know all the things. You don't have, you know, Allah say, ask me about that. So I can help you with it. So we can. And so, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for, la ilaha illallah. Asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to heal the root of it, right? And to heal the memory that is connected to it. So, again, sometimes it can be an event or a principle that we've held that we have to get, you know, to the bottom of it. Because if not, what happens is that when the root of it, when the root of the sin isn't healed, then usually we're bound to commit that, to have that continuously. But the biggest obstacle to removing a sin of the heart is the unwillingness to admit it. Because the unwillingness to admit it will not lead one to repent from it. And the greatest help is the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to ask for His tawfiq. So the first thing is to just be able to tell yourself the flat truth about that. Right? And there, all of us have something. We have to tell ourselves the flat truth. Like, actually, you know, Aisha, you know, you were really vain about that. Well, you know, actually, Aisha, you know, you have a deep sense of entitlement, right? Actually, yeah, Aisha, you know, you thought you were better because you were American. Well, you thought you were better because you were educated. Or you thought you were better because you came from, you have more money. There are lots of things that we tell ourselves that later on we're like, I like my mom. And alhamdulillah, it doesn't make you a horrible person. It makes you a really good person carrying around a very bad trait. Alhamdulillah, if you, again, when it happens, if you don't commit, if you don't do this to yourself, or if you don't pacify yourself, it's okay. Everybody sins. Everybody has mistakes. Well, I am better because, I mean, you know, I am cuter or whatever. Right? Or whatever we tell ourselves. As long as we don't pacify ourselves, to be honest. Like in our day and age, we're the generation of don't pass judgment. Right? Now you better pass some judgment. Because judgment is going to get passed. Right? So it better be a good thing right now. If you just say, no, really? That quality is not a quality of Ahlul Jannah. You got to get rid of that. Without putting yourself back in the way. Hear what I'm saying for that. How do we put ourselves back in the way? Even if we beat ourselves up to the point of having low self-esteem, then we have still committed the same act as vanity or arrogance. Why? Because it's still about you. Right? It's still you in the way. It's still you standing in the way. It's just the flip side of the same coin. So as opposed to, I may not be worthy of a lot of things, but Allah is worthy of me being better. That's how you get yourself out of the way. You're welcome. Ya Allah, give me ikhlas. Ya Allah, give me siddiq. Ya Allah, just be a beggar. Ya Rabbi, here I am at your door again. Begging, Ya Rabbi, make me a person of ikhlas. Make me a person of siddiq. Right? And honestly, having moments where you sit with yourself and you tell yourself the truth. You have to have moments with yourself where you sit with yourself and tell yourself the flat truth. You know the story of the one who entered into the masjid, right? And the Prophet said, the next person who enters into the doors, Ahlul Jannah. And they said, what is it? You know, the companions are like, I wonder what it is about him. And Omar stayed with him for 3 days. And in the end, right, he's like, I don't see anything so great, special about you. I didn't see you get up for fasting. I didn't get see you get up for Qiyam al-Layl. And he said, no, I don't. He said, there's only one thing that I do. Every night I sit before I go to bed and I think about my day. And I ask myself, is there anything that, is there anyone who did something to me that I need to forgive them for? And is there anything about myself, right, that I need to seek someone else's forgiveness or a trait that I need to uproot it from my heart? Right? So the fact that he didn't, and then Omar immediately said, that's why. that's the quality. That muraqabah, that self-watching, and being able to tell yourself the truth, right? To be able to sit and say, you know, to go through your day and say, I wasn't very kind to the cashier. I'm just giving an example. I wasn't very kind to the cashier. And then say, well, what is the root of that? Why weren't you kind to the cashier? Well, I was tired. Okay, well, that's not a reason to put it on the cashier, right? Yeah, actually, because I thought I was better than her because she was just a mere cashier and I have a PhD or whatever. When you can keep tracing the root, now you can repent for the reality because you're just telling yourself, oh, I'm just tired. You're giving yourself the excuse, which means you're going to commit it again against somebody else. Next will be the waitress, right? So being able to sit with myself and say, well, why was I, you know, why did I behave that way? Oh, the truth is I feel entitled. I feel like I should have that. Why should you have it? Because I'm from Florida. Whatever it is. Like we tell her, I mean, we laugh. right? But there are different things we tell ourselves. Because I'm American. Because I'm Autumn. Because I'm African-American. Because my daddy used to spoil me. Why can't the rest of the world? I don't know, whatever it is. You know, whatever the root is. But we have it. There's a root, you know? There's a root, for sure. Why were you mean to her? I was jealous. Why are you jealous of her? Because she's beautiful. And I don't actually believe that I'm that beautiful. So really, I'm insecure about my own beauty. So I was jealous of her, so then I was mean. It's that, it's, we gotta be able to sink, just take a deep breath and go a little deeper. And ask yourself, interrogate yourself. Interrogate your nafs. Why did you do that? Why did you say that? Why were you impatient about that? Yes. Interrogate your nafs. I'm so serious. Before we're interrogated. Yeah. And your shayateen, by the way. Pinned them to the wall. I'm not kidding. I'm serious. You sit and speak to them. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ. I seek refuge in Allah from you, and I'm about to read on you. You shayateen and qarin who walk around with me every day, I'm reciting ayatul kursi on you. I'm telling Allah on you. You acting out. You're calling me to all kind of foolishness. I'm serious. I'm serious. You guys think I'm kidding? I'm serious. I am serious. You guys are reciting. You're reciting your adhkar in the morning. Who are you reciting for? Right? You're talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows you're seeking refuge in you when you're talking about the قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ. Sometimes we're putting it. That's the funny thing. Sometimes we're putting it on the act. I'm seeking refuge in you, you magician. Actually, I'm seeking refuge in Allah from you. Right? I'm seeking refuge in Allah. You, subhanAllah, you temperamental chick. You gotta talk to yourself.
You know, because I really have to, you know, like, go away and let me do, you know, let me do the thing. So it's, you know, sometimes it gets that bad.
Yes. Drown them out. You know how you drown them out? You ever been in a house and you heard something or something scared you? And you play you pray Siddle to Bucket real loud? You ever did that? Do that to your nafs. I'm about to drown you out. I'm about to play this Quran so loud till you can't think about nothing else. I am serious, right? But right now, I really want to listen to Beyonce. I'm in the car. You about to turn this bucket on real loud until you just hear just that, till you drown out your own thoughts. Don't worry, we have days like that. But work on it. Right? I'm serious. Like, you know, Imam al-Haddan, he talks of, like, this, like, dragging your nafs to obedience. Honestly, dragging your nafs to obedience. Because if not, they will drag you into laziness, into ghafla, into heedlessness. So it's when they talk about fighting against your nafs, sometimes it's a real fight. Sometimes it's a real struggle. Like, you know, I can see today, you know, there are days like, I can see you're not going to let me rest today. You're not going to let me have peace today. I can see. So okay, that's fine. I'm about to call the big dog. I'm about to play Hizb al-Nasr on you. I'm serious. I'm about to play Hizb al-Nasr. Right? Oh, okay. Oh, okay. I see you. You want to make, you know, you want to make me pick a fight. Today you wanted me to pick a fight with my husband. Okay, that's what you're doing. Yeah. No, we're not doing that. I'm about to pray with a Latif. Loud. But I'm serious. You have to, you know, you have to split yourself. I know that sounds weird. Don't worry. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. Right? Like, you have to put your nub. Like, you have to say, okay, I'm talking to you, nubs. I'm talking to you, Shahla. I'm talking to you, my desire. And you, the shayateen, I'm talking to you. You, I'm not even going to speak to directly. I'm just going to funk and gnash you to death. I had to curse you right into submission. Like, I know you, because if not, when you keep doing it, we don't have the strength. We have to call for backup. We have to call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to run and pray to raka'at and say, Ya Rabbi, I'm running to you. I'm just seeking refuge in you. They are after me. Ya Rabbi, these shayateen, they're after me. My nafs is after me today. Ya Rabbi, I need help. Sometimes I know, the adhkar are, mashallah, tabarak rahman, the adhkar with concentration, they definitely work. But sometimes we need a way to the adhkar. Sometimes it's difficult. Like the adhkar is like over there, right? And you're like, my nafs won't let me get up out this chair. I won't even push it on the phone. I could just put it on play. I can't even do that. You have to just, subhanAllah, I think about with the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to sit and make tayammum before he would go to make wudu. Part of it was about, let me put out the flames of shaitan even before, unless something tried to distract me between here and my wudu. Also, it was like, I'm just going to do an act of ibadah. Like, let me just help. Sometimes you have to even make dua, Ya Rabbi, bless me to read. That's why the dua, Allahumma aini ala dhikrik wa shukrik wa husni ibadatik. Oh Allah, help me remember you. Help me make dhikr of you. Help me be grateful to you. So I can actually get the strength in the mind to say the adhkar. Allahumma na udhu biki min hammi wa hazan wa udhu biki min ajiz wa kasan. I'm seeking refuge in you from my laziness. We all fall into that. Don't, you know? I say that we all fall into it to say you're not alone. Right? But it doesn't absolve us of responsibility. We still have to do something. We have to fight. Have to fight. Allahumma salli wa sallam alayhi wa sallam. First the moment, the shimmering light of Habib Omar, just reciting it and reading it and reading it and reading it. The other thing is the Shema'in, reading the Shema'in. I can remember the moment, to be honest. It was the narration where it described the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is that when he was amongst people, if they laughed, he laughed. And whatever they talked about, he would talk about that. And if they were, you know, if they were happy, he would be happy. And if they were, like, awed by something, he would. And that, for me, was, like, fascinating, right? Like, learning that the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wasn't the buzzkill at a party, right? He wasn't the one that was, like, you know? He was relatable and fun. And the fact that, you know, he laughed till you could see his molars. Just Allahumma salli wa sallam. Just imagine seeing that, like seeing him, you know, to see someone's molars, that means they have to put their head back, you know, and laugh. Yeah. Also, I'm a crazy woman. I talk to the Prophet. You got to be a little crazy. And people are like, what? What are you saying, Sister Aisha? When I heard that he's alive in his grave, right, and you send salawat, every time you send salawat, there's an angel that wraps your salawat and goes and stands in a line to give your salam to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, except on Laylatul Jum'ah. So on Laylatul Jum'ah, he hears it directly, and then he responds by your name. So then I was like, so that's it, right? Salaam alaikum ya Rasulullah. So this is what happened. Salaam alaikum ya Rasulullah. If I, you know, he would touch some salawat in between. He's alive in his grave, right? This is a mu'jiza. This is our aqidah. This is what we believe, that the anbiya are alive in their graves, right? This is like, it's a matter of our deen. And so send salawat on him, read about him, you know, find something. You know what causes your heart to love, right? We all have something like that pulls our heart to love someone. Find out what is that thing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has it, right? And just keep walking that path and think about it and send salawat and think about that and send salawat. Like him and Ieasha racing on horses. That was so cute, right? I'm like him in the masjid, and she's sitting on his shoulders, right? As she's like watching, you know, the Ethiopian military dancers. That for me, and he's like, "You finish? Nah." I had supper with her. You know, there's lots of things, like, you know, for me. So you have to find. There's not everything. You know, there's some things like, oh, that doesn't read. You know, everybody has that key to their own heart. You have to know what is that key to your heart with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And just keep thinking about that and dwelling that. You know, when you love someone, you keep thinking about, if you've ever been in love, right, where you're like, remember that time we were walking in the park? Remember that time we saw the dolphins? Remember that time we, you have to do that with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right? I remember that time he was talking to Ieasha radhiyallahu anha. Man, I can't imagine like how, what was he thinking when those girls were singing to him, Ta'ala badru halayna. Like thinking about him and Abu Bakr in the cave. You know, you have to know what's your thing. Or like the time he's sleeping and Safiya, his aunt, he's sweating. It's hot in the middle of the day and he's sweating. And she has a bottle, right? And she's collecting his sweat. And he wakes up. He's like, "What are you doing?" Right? That for me is fun. Like, it's just funny. Like, it's just such a real moment. If you woke up and somebody had a bottle next to you, you'd be like, "What are you doing?" You know, that for me, yeah. You have to, for me, it's those real, when he's just, you know, just with his family and, those for me are the moments of love. Okay. So the first thing is, when you seek refuge in Allah from shaitan and you still have this conversation, that's your nafs. Right? It's like, I sought refuge from Allah and this is still circling. That's you. Right? So that's one thing. The other thing is that your nafs is not necessarily negative. Right? Meaning that the nafs is actually neutral. And this is actually something, subhanAllah, a lot of people confuse, because for the most part it's down, but that's our attachment to dunya that actually pulls it down. But our nafs can actually raise up when we are more attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So it's literally like a pendulum. So when we are more attached to dunya, it's our nafs that causes, like, I really just want to sleep. I just really want to. Actually, I just want to binge watch Netflix. I want to, you know, that part, it's actually not necessarily a bad thing, right? I just want to binge watch Netflix. When does shaitan come in? When I want to watch something I know I shouldn't. Right? I'm interested in this, that. Hey, I know. That even maybe normally I wouldn't. Right? It's not something I'm interested in. Well, maybe get curious about that. Now we're, make sense? Now we're going down a path, shouldn't we? The other thing is that the psychology, you have to talk to Dr. Rania, like the psychology behind imposter syndrome and all of that. I'm not so intelligent about that. The only thing when that happens to me As I say, it really doesn't matter. Meaning, and why do I say it doesn't matter? Because, okay, if I'm not true, y'all don't be making me true. And well, are you sincere about that? Y'all don't be making me sincere. You know, y'all don't be, this whispering is, it's trying to help me. I'm running to you away from whatever this voice is, whatever this waswas is, whether it's for me or something like that. And in the end, it doesn't matter. Meaning that the self-doubt we have is also a trick. It's just trying to get in your way. It's just trying to be a hurdle. Right? It's just trying to keep you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, I'm putting you on blast too. Right? Like, even if I think, Ya Allah, in one of the du'as I make is, Allah, make me Muslim. Make me a Muslim. Some days I'm Muslim, some days, you know, all of us. Because Muslim is one who actively submits to the will of Allah. Right? Some days we're like, Ya Rabbi, I know that's your will. You know? And so, push. I might not be Muslim yet, but I'm still going to pray and ask Allah to make me a Muslim. Because I want to be a Muslim. Law. It doesn't, I think we are confusing. I think we think that somehow we're going to want it. And we don't always want to want it. That's the truth of it. Like sometimes I have to tell myself, Ya Allah, I don't really want to fast Mondays and Thursdays. I really don't. I'd rather eat. I'd rather drink coffee and eat some ice cream. That's my nafs. My nafs is like, we could just like wait to Ramadan. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's nafs. So I have to say, Allah, the truth is I don't want to. And that's the truth. Can you make want to? Can you cause my heart to yearn for it? Can you put the inclination to worship you in my heart? And, you know, Jazakum Allah Khair. I think this is saying that time is up. Alhamdulillah. With the candy. I love the sweetness of it all. So that's it, right? Like, really saying, again, that's that thing about when we tell ourselves the truth. Like, I'm Muslim. Sometimes I struggle. Sometimes I want to do it. Sometimes I don't want to do it. Oh Allah, give me istiqamah in wanting to worship you. And even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned about when he said that sometimes you don't feel connected. Believe it or not, not feeling connected is not a bad thing. What do I mean by that? Because then you know you're not worshiping Allah for the feeling. You know you're not committing that shirk of, I'm worshiping Allah because I'm going to get this feeling from it. The truth is, maybe from my perspective, right, from my zahir perspective, I'm not feeling anything right now. But I didn't worship because of me. I worship because Allah, I'm worshiping Allah. It wasn't about me. So in my worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I feel it, well, alhamdulillah. If I didn't feel it, well, alhamdulillah. It's not. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's not going, our emotions should not, that's our nafs trying to drag and pull us all over the room. Right? Some people say, well, when I feel it, then I'll pray. No. That's a trick. Our shaitan is just trying to use our feelings and our emotions, you know. So I'm here. I'm showing up. Ya Rabbi, please attach my heart to you. Ya Rabbi, I'm asking you for sakina. I'm asking you for the sweetness of iman. I'm asking you for the sweetness in my prayer. But that's what I was saying in the beginning. What if I never get the sweetness of prayer? What if I never gain it? Do I stop worshiping Allah? Absolutely not, because His Allah is still there. His Allah is not dependent on my feelings. So, you know, it's very intelligent, like imposter syndrome. I don't know about that. Sometimes we're all just Faking it to make it. Allah, make me sincere. Please make me sincere. Ya Rabbi, make me sincere.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.